Hi, everyone. I'm Monsignor Jim Flawn, and welcome to Good News. And as always, I welcome Karen Dagher-Smith, my co-host, to the show.
Hello.
Good to have you, and
Hi,
happy
Monsignor.
Lent to you.
Can you say happy Lent?
Blessed Lent.
Okay. I always wonder about that.
I love, you know, there's something beautiful about, like, I don't love denial, of course.
Yes.
You know that about me.
Yes.
But at the same time, the scriptures of Lent, I love.
Really?
So, yeah, because the readings are so rich and beautiful, and there's a lot of, you know, like, Jesus' temptation, and all of these things are really, really something that could feed us in
Lent.
Yeah. I love
it. As a child, Lent was always a little bit scary
because
from going to a Catholic school and a Catholic family, and it was a lot of, okay, you need to give something up.
Right, right, right.
And we're not eating meat on these days. And I was always like, oh, my God.
Now, how do you deal with that on Fridays? Like the fish cakes? Or you don't have fish cakes, forget
no,
it.
No.
That's like an old man thing. I love them.
I love fish, but my husband does not. My children certainly do not. So what we've decided to do this year for Lent is, as a family, we're going to make pizzas from scratch every
Friday.
Oh, that's
Friday, a nice idea. That's kind of
cool.
Which,
I mean, it's kind of a treat, but it's also a nice way for us to come together
as a family. Spend some time together, and there's a reason for it, because it's Lent, right?
Yes.
That's kind of a cool
idea. Make your own
pizzas.
But we actually get the dough from the pizza place on the corner.
Yeah, but that's all right. That's
okay?
No,
okay.
You got to do that. That takes too long otherwise to do that. That's pretty nice. That's a great thing.
Yeah, right? It should be good.
Now, are you doing anything special for Lent with the family? You figured that out yet?
You know, we've talked about what to do as a family for Lent, and part of that is doing something related to service. I always feel like, especially with my kids, I want them to get in the habit of doing things for others.
Good idea.
Luckily, I live in a great town where they have things that are already built in.
Yeah.
You can go to the ceramic place on the corner, make a bowl, and then donate the bowl to the soup kitchen in town.
Oh, that's a cool
idea.
And
they'll use that to give food. So it's good for the kids, and it's appropriate for their age, but it also teaches a lesson.
Nice idea.
So that's
I like
what
that.
We're thinking
and plus
about.
In the school, Long Beach Catholic, you'll be doing lots of stuff there, too, I'm
always.
Sure, right?
It's ingrained in the curriculum. Yes.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah,
and Lent is, you know, it's a good reminder to us because it talks about service to the church and service to Jesus, you know, and that's an important part of all of our lives, right?
I mean, it doesn't have to be scary.
No, right, exactly right. It's something we can celebrate and be happy about,
yes.
This idea of serving God with our lives and doing something extra. So we have people on our show today who are doing that in different ways. We have Barbara Samuels, Catholic. For the freedom of religion, you know, they'll be here. And she's talking about Catholics at the Capitol, which is coming up in Albany.
That's right,
so she's going to talk to us a little bit about that. And then I'm very happy about this one. We have the new bishop-elect in our diocese.
Oh.
Bishop-elect Andrzej. Can you say his last name?
Absolutely not. I won't even do that.
Shay Slefsky.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been practicing it for months.
He spoke to the teachers in the diocese, Rockville Center, and he was wonderful.
Yeah,
and you know, near and dear
speaker.
To my heart, people learning English as a second language and immigrants, I work with them every night.
Sure.
He had such a great story and funny little tales about when he first came to this country, and just a great man.
Great, great gift, and I'm glad he's going to be with us so you get a chance to know him a little bit better. He's going to be ordained a priest on March 25th, bishop
on
March
amazing.
25th.
Exciting.
So we'll have that opportunity to, you'll see that live on Telecare too. And then the night before, there's an evening prayer service, and we'll all be together for that on Telecare
too. What a great honor.
So it's going to be fun, you know, and I think it's a great gift for the church, and it brings excitement to the church.
Definitely.
Excitement to the diocese, and you'll get to, like I said, meet him firsthand, which is kind of a cool thing.
Awesome. Very good.
So it should be fun. So it will be Happy Lent.
Okay, fine.
Put it there.
Done.
Let's get going. On March 19th, Timothy Cardinal Dolan and the bishops of New York State will join hundreds of fellow Catholic New Yorkers at the annual Catholics at the Capitol Public Policy Advocacy Day in Albany. Some will meet with legislators, while others will serve as a visible presence in the halls of the state capitol. Well, it's our privilege and our duty as both Catholics and American citizens to stand up for our beliefs in the public square and defend those without a voice of their own. Well, our next guest has been a driving force with her organization, Catholics for Freedom of Religion, and will be honored for her work at this important event. Please welcome back to our program, Barbara Samuels. Barbara, thanks for being with us.
Yeah, welcome back.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm so pleased and thrilled.
Now, I know this campaign that goes on every year for us, our Advocacy Day, right now is closed. Like, people can't join with us, but there is certainly much, much that people can do if they're not necessarily traveling to Albany, right?
Yes, yes, there is. They can go to the website of the New York State Catholic Conference, and there on the website you can click on Catholics to the Capitol, and that will bring you to a page where you can look at the five issues that the bishops are stressing this year. And the first issue, the abortion expansion bill, which not only would expand abortion into the ninth month, but it would also take away the freedom of conscience of healthcare providers to choose whether or not to participate. And their licensing can depend upon whether they participate in these abortions or not. I mean, it opens an unbelievably heinous situation for people who object to destruction of life in the womb. So there's a lot that people can do. They can pray, but they need to educate themselves, and they need then to educate those around them. And that's what we're all about with Catholics for Freedom of Religion.
And that's kind of how you got involved, right? I mean, it was your personal experience with what was going on federally that said, wait a minute, something's very wrong here, right?
Yes. When the Health and Human Services mandate came out, and it was, to me, such a direct, obvious, black and white, deliberate denial of religious freedom. And all my life, everything I heard was, oh, that speech you're hearing over there, that's objectionable to you. But to preserve First Amendment freedom of speech for everyone, we support their right to say the things we object to.
Sure.
And I thought, how can this be that this not only takes away the freedom of conscience of people who object to these things, but therefore it takes away from everyone?
Right.
And so how can we stand for this? And to me, when I read it the first time, I couldn't believe it. When I read the second time what the Health and Human Services mandate said and dictated, the world changed. Our country changed. And our country, with its freedom of religion, is the beacon for the rest of the world. People look to us. People sometimes give their lives, risk their lives to come here for freedom of religion.
Which is precisely what the president said at the National Prayer Breakfast. Not that I want to get into that directly, but it's precisely what he even said to all of us, right, ultimately.
Now, I'm sorry, Barbara, I know so many people, like you were saying, were very fired up when they heard about that, what was going on. What motivated you to go from that feeling of being just incredulous and fired up to taking the steps to doing something about it?
There were a couple things that motivated me. My conversations with people outside of church, where they were saying, what can we do?
Right.
What can we do? Because there were many people who realized what is at stake. And I thought to myself, and the wheels started turning, about that time Cardinal Dolan spoke at Holy Trinity High School about the role of the laity, that it is the role of the laity and the special gift from the Holy Spirit of the laity to take our Catholic teachings into the public square. So I started reading a little bit more about this and read what various popes have said about the same thing. And I thought, there has to be a way to do this. We cannot put this whole burden on our clergy.
Right.
It is our church. And the clergy are there to teach, but their role is teaching and guidance and inspiration. Our role, our unique role, as Cardinal Dolan pointed out, is to take this into the Catholic square. And as someone told me yesterday, I was speaking to a man from Virginia who actually put together this booklet about religious freedom in the public schools. And this little pamphlet we are going to give out to thousands of students on Long Island.
Oh, great.
But this man said to me, we need to be a lamp that glows brightly for religious freedom. He said, not a blowtorch. He said, but a lamp. And I said to him, yes, but you know what? We need to turn up the luminescence on that lamp and turn up the intensity. And we cannot allow that lamp to be put, as politicians are saying now, to be locked. We cannot have that lamp locked inside the four walls of our church and defined as freedom of worship, as opposed to freedom of religion.
Right.
Freedom of worship, go practice in your church, pray and talk about your faith. Do not take it into the public square
with
freedom of
worship. The marketplace is a separate spot, right.
That's right. That's
now, you've had some, victories, and I think that's worth noting, too, that this is not just like, you know, I'm thinking of that movie Joe Against the Volcano, you know, like it's just like a little drop in the ocean. Like, you've had some significant victory in this work that you've done, and I know you have a book that kind of illustrates a lot of that. But I mean, why don't you speak about some of these victories? Because I mean, I know I've participated in a number of rallies. Those alone are victories in my book. But talk a little bit more about that.
Yes, this book is our story. The volunteers put this together. This is the story of Catholics for Freedom of Religion. So far, there are pictures of you in here. we have some very good pictures. In the past, in almost 2 years since we started thinking about this and then started working on it, I would say we've made a good start, but only a start. And that start was enabled because of the diocese that we are in. And with Bishop Murphy, with your help, with the help of many people in the diocese, we've gone forward. The rallies that we have had have been not only big attractions for people. I mean, the Rosary rally that we had outside Good Samaritan Hospital for the preservation of Catholic health care and religious freedom, that morning was so threatening. It had rained. Oh. It was wet. It was gray. It looked like it could rain at any time. And yet 750 people came that day.
Right.
And you spoke. And we, even though we could only capture you for a little while that day, we were very glad to have you there. And that's a real victory. Mm. And what that does is, for the people who were there, if there were 750 people there, they all have friends, family, and fellow parishioners.
That's right.
People left that day, just as they left the rally, moved and changed, mm-hmm. because they'd done something they never did before. They stood with their fellow lay Catholics in public witness and in prayer along Montauk Highway.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
They're praying the Rosary. And I know I had a very hard time not crying through that whole last rosary.
Yeah.
Oh my, yes.
Yeah.
It was really a transformational experience. So we've had wonderful successes like that. And then also, we've had wonderful success in parishes where we bring guest speakers in.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the challenge here, mm-hmm. is to let people know, to educate and inform them that your religious liberty is gone. It is gone.
Which is not partisan, by the way. It has nothing to do with your party affiliation, right?
No, it has not. We're completely nonpartisan.
Sure.
We are encouraging, we are educating and advocating for First Amendment freedom of religion, mm-hmm. for all Americans of all faiths.
Mm-hmm.
And we reach out, and we're reaching out more all the time to other faith communities around us, to speakers from other faith communities.
Which is good,
because some of them are aware, some of them are not. Mm-hmm. But we're all Americans.
Yeah.
And whether we're of this faith, that faith, or no faith, our First Amendment is what protects us.
Mm-hmm.
Our founders knew that. They wrote it the way they did for very, very specific reasons. So yes, we're not partisan. What we do in the parishes, what we do in the diocese is nonpartisan. We're not pushing for any candidate, any
mm-hmm.
party.
Right.
We're pushing for freedom of religion for every American. And I think that's one of the reasons why we have success, because people wake up, the
that's
light
right.
goes on,
sure.
and they say, you're right.
Wait a minute.
You're right. This is what is happening. So with our speakers, and just lately we've had a wonderful, wonderful man, Tom Renker, the general counsel for the diocese.
Know him well, yeah.
He traveled with me to New Jersey before Christmas, and we spoke for freedom of religion there to a gathering. And Tom may regret that, because now he has spoken, I think, at one other parish, and now he has three on the books that he's going to speak
at.
As a matter of fact, tonight he's speaking at Corpus Christi. Although
he's an articulate guy, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Now let me ask you this question before you go, because you're not going to like it. So I've got to ask.
Oh
you.
No!
Well, she's a humble person. She's not going to be talking about her being honored.
Okay. Yes.
But you're going to receive an award.
Yes.
And again, I know that's not what you're about, and I know you know that's difficult for you. But why don't you just tell everybody about that briefly?
Well, you know what? That's what I'm all about, and I'll tell you why. We find, as Catholics for Freedom of Religion, we need credentials. Because if I go to Florida, or if I go to Indiana, or I go to Ohio, you know, a pastor will look at me and say, who are you?
Right.
And why should I speak to you? And so forth. So Bishop Murphy gave Eileen and me each a letter of introduction and that we use, and this award is a wonderful thing.
Good. Okay,
but it
good
is part of our credentials. And the way I found out about the award, I was speaking one morning at our organizer's workshop, and we're there working, and because both my parents are ill, I always have my cell phone in my mm-hmm. pocket on silent vibration. And my phone went off, and I picked it up. It wasn't my brother's, so I hung up. It said private, you know, restricted. I hung up.
When I checked
my email, uh-oh. I hung up on Bishop Murphy.
No!
And it took me a while not to hyperventilate when I listened to the voicemail that he would like me to call him. And that was him telling me about this award.
Isn't
what
that
an honor.
It
good.
Is.
Well
I'm
deserved.
Glad for you.
It
and
is.
I, like I said, I'm glad you're
it
accepting
is.
It in that spirit, because
yes.
I think it's a great thing to do and to acknowledge the hard work that you've done. And I'll tell you, you've made an impact and like throwing a rock in this pond that has rippled out. You can just see it happening. Mm-hmm. It's very exciting to watch.
It must ripple, and the potential is there, and the people are there.
That's right.
And I was calculating today as I was driving here, we are probably on Long Island in this diocese over 15,000 volunteer hours now that have gone into this. And the volunteers that step forward are amazing.
That's great.
Are amazing. Yeah. And the work they do is incredible. And that's what the award is for.
That's
it's
great.
Not for me. It's not for Eileen. It's for all the work that these volunteers have done.
Give us your
How
website
amazing.
Again, Laura.
It's CatholicsForFreedomOfReligion.org.
And they can come and speak to your group. They can come and speak, get people interested, get people excited about their faith, living it out. And they're doing great work.
Yeah.
It's really a grassroots effort in so many ways that involves every single one of us here in this country and beyond, actually. So important things. So Barbara, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Keep us abreast, because you know
I will.
You've got an open invitation here.
We're getting ready. We're getting ready for the Fortnight for Freedom. So there are many things planned and coming up. So we will be in touch.
Good.
I'm glad for that. That's good. All right, we're going
to
take a quick break. We have more good news right after this. Welcome back, everyone. On February 11th, Pope Francis proclaimed his appointment of Monsignor Andrzej Szaslewski as Auxiliary Bishop of the Diocese of Rockville-Senna. I was at St. Agnes Cathedral with our telecare cameras to capture this exciting announcement and was able to interview our new bishop-elect. Let's take a look.
Thank you all for coming this morning, and I appreciate your presence and also the opportunity to share with you some very good news for the Diocese of Rockville-Senna. I am very grateful to the Holy Father for giving our diocese this good and holy priest of many talents to assist me in the pastoral cares of the 1.5 million Catholics of our diocese. I know the priests, deacons, liturgical ministers, and all the people of God will welcome this appointment from our Holy Father, as I have, with gratitude to God and with great joy that through the choice of Pope Francis, we are blessed with a bishop who will serve this church as a bishop just as he has served it so well as a priest. And so with great joy and happiness, I give to you Bishop-elect Szaslewski.
Those who know me know very well how uncomfortable I am even to read my homilies from a paper, from a text. I always like to improvise and speak from my heart. So just imagine how overwhelmed I am with the special call from Holy See and with this very special appointment. So not being a man of just very few words, I also have the statement which I would like to share with you as my response to this very special privilege. So I do think that everyone who is surprised as I am this morning by this news coming from Rome will understand why my heart and mind turns into a wonder and joy, great gratitude. I am deeply humbled by Holy Father's appointment, even though I always wanted to serve God and the Church in the best way I can. I am overwhelmed with a sense of my unworthiness. And for that reason, I turn all my emotions and all feelings into the song of thanksgiving and gratitude. First of all, I want to thank Holy Father, Pope Francis. This appointment not only shows his great concern for the church here on Long Island, but also is a concrete way of reaching out to all the faithful here in the Diocese of Rockville-Senna. I do believe and think that Holy Father recognizes the depth and enthusiasm of spiritual life coming together with amazing exchange of all different cultures and diversities in our diocese.
Pope Francis today, on the memorial of Our Lady of Lourdes, has named Monsignor Andrzej Szaslewski, who is the Chancellor of the Diocese of Rockville-Senna, to Auxiliary Bishop. And joining us right now is the Bishop-elect. Congratulations.
Jim, thank you very much.
What
thank
a great
you very
day.
Much. It is a great day and, of course, a big surprise to me, but I am humble and very much honored by this special call that Holy Father appointed me to be an auxiliary of this wonderful diocese that was the diocese of my home, the Diocese of Rockville-Senna. So it is truly a humbling experience, but I am so grateful that I can still share my life and my priesthood in this wonderful place that 25 years ago became my home.
What a wonderful thing. Now, have you been able to contact your family back in Poland, let them know this wonderful news?
I did call them this morning, and actually I was very happy that my mother with my sister was able to watch Telecare online. So thank to you. They were able to see the mass, morning mass from the cathedral and you know, find out also this way and celebrate this day with me.
That's wonderful. How about your motto? Do you have a motto chosen yet?
No, not yet, but of course I am praying and contemplating, and my thoughts are closer these days to Mary. I was always had a great devotion to Mary, so keep saying to myself, even hearing about the will of the Holy Father, fias voluntas tua, so let it be done according to your will, and I'm pretty sure that this is going to be my episcopal motto.
Well, that was an exciting day, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. What a great honor.
I love that. Yeah. And, you know, we've been so lucky in our diocese. I mean, we've had a number of new bishops in a recent amount of time. So, I mean, we have a lot of really wonderful...
And we've been able to interview them all here.
Yes.
And they're just wonderful people doing
And
God's
he's going
work.
To be ordained on March 25th. So
we're
going to be providing that all live.
Great.
And the 24th is an evening prayer service on the evening before the ordination. We'll have that on live,
good.
Too. So we'll be able to follow Bishop Szaslewski as he gets ordained.
Very exciting.
Pretty good. His last name, boy, I wish you could put that on the screen. I've had to study that for a long time to be able to say that right.
You did a great job.
He's a great man, though, and we're so proud of him.
Yes.
All right, we have to take another short break. Stick around. We got lots more good news right after this. Welcome back, everyone. Well, certainly a great show to talk about service in the life of the church and recognizing the power of service. You're doing it with your kids, right?
I'm trying.
Recognizing that. You know, you want to work with teenagers today. That's about service, too.
Yeah.
Getting them involved in these service trips that they do to help others. It's a life-altering experience,
I was just
going
to say that. It's something, as I did as a child or a teenager in high school, it's something you don't forget the rest of your life and carry it with you. It is important.
It's an amazing thing when that happens, when your life is changed that way, you know? I remember when I was in the seminary, just starting in the seminary, there was a priest there who I've had on this show, actually, real honor for me, Father Robert Lauder. And he said to me, Jim, I want you to come with me to the Catholic Worker. It was 1979. And he brought me to the Catholic Worker. There was a woman there named Dorothy Day. And talking about a person who lived her life in service, there's a great example. And having that experience of going with him, I went for a number of weeks, for a number of years, to the Catholic Worker every Friday. And there was this experience of serving the poor and being with the poor that kind of inspired me in my own journey to priesthood, because it helped feed that, to recognize that it's not just academics, it's not just prayer, but it's action. And that's an important part of our lives, to be able to have action in our lives as well. Each and every one of us has been called to a vocation of service in some way. It's about finding what that is in your life, finding how that is in your life and what you're going to do about it. And it changes, it seems, as time goes on. I know in my own life, when I was a younger priest, there was a certain gift of service to God's young people. And now, as an old man, it's my service to you, my service to you on television, the way God has called me to preach the gospel in this particular way at this particular time. There's something beautiful about recognizing that in our lives, that as our lives develop and change, the vocation remains the same. How it plays itself out seems to change a little bit. And I go back to those very early days. I'm fresh out of high school, and this priest said to me, he was my teacher in school, and he said to me after class that one Friday, I want you to come with me to the Catholic Worker in New York. I didn't even know what a Catholic Worker was. And all of a sudden, that moment helped inspire me and helped me to study harder, to pray harder, because I wanted to serve God in that particular way. All of us are called to that kind of fervor, in a sense, and to keep that fervor going. It's not easy, but that's something that's part of all of our lives, right?
Yeah, especially when God puts these people in your path. Mm-hmm. You got to meet Dorothy Day?
Well, actually, I got to see Dorothy.
Okay.
I met her once.
Though.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So, I mean, she would never know me or anything like that. But at the same time, that just the experience of being with her, and I didn't even know who she was when I first met her. Because I'm like, well, this is the lady who ran it. I guess she's very elderly and not so well, but okay. And then as time went on, as I read her story and I read her autobiography and learned more about her,
you say, wow,
there's a real gift in my life that Father Bob Lauder introduced to me.
How
many years
incredible.
Back. So what a great gift, right?
Yeah.
That's part of all of our lives. We're called to that gift of service. So we keep it going, right?
And we keep trying.
Never
every
know.
Day.
Somebody will say, Karen Danka-Smith introduced me to this, and you'll be the inspiration.
Oh, I hope so.
I'm hoping.
Keep
got
trying.
My fingers crossed. All right, well, that's our show for this week. Remember, whatever you do this week,
keep on spreading the good news.
God bless everybody.
Bye,
see you
everyone.
Soon.